Hi, you have found Rides with Chuck. In this video, we visit Midwest Helicopter and take a look at a working 1958 Sikorsky helicopter. This morning, the job is at O'Hare Airport. Though the helicopter can cruise at 125 miles per hour, the ground crew has to fight traffic. They get a big head start. When the call comes in that they're in position, and only then, does the Sikorsky take off. Hear what the pilot has to say. Meet Jim Triggs.
Well, this is our helicopter. It's a Sikorsky 58T. T is for turbine conversion. These aircraft are originally equipped with a radial Wright 1820 engine. About the 70s, they were converted over with turbine packages. Some of them still stayed radial, but quite a bit got transformed to the twin turbine conversion. This aircraft, 129 November Hotel, formerly of New York Helicopter Airways, is a pretty big helicopter operation out in New York. We acquired it, I would say, probably in the 90s. It used to be a red, white, and blue from the New York helicopter paint job. We switched over a few years ago to our company colors, the orange, black, and white. And up here is where the engines are at. A lot of people think the helicopter engines are on the top of the aircraft, but on this aircraft, they're down below. And what we got here is the engines are side by side, and kind of unusual setup is where these would normally be on an aircraft called like a King Air, where the output shaft to come out the front here to the propeller. In our situation, it's connected to this gearbox that combines both engines to one dry shaft that goes back between both engines, which powers the main rotor system. So it's a little different than what normally people see, but there's a lot of stuff going on up front here. The engines combine in this aircraft. These are dash six engines. The other aircraft we got here is dash three. The only major difference is the horsepower, and it's not much. This aircraft's got about 1,875 horsepower. The other aircraft's got about 1,800 horsepower. These engines are designed to run a little bit cooler than the dash threes, a little bit newer design, and very reliable. I mean, Pratt & Whitney's are great engines. Always have been around for a long time. It's not pretty simple design. To go over here, talk a little bit about the fuel. As you can see, we got a 1,000-gallon fuel truck here. I got to fill it up for today's job. The aircraft has three tanks, although the rear two tanks are the same. The other door fuel nozzle or fuel port is behind the door there. Those are the same tank, they just cross feed into each other. The total capacity is 292 gallons of jet fuel on this aircraft. It may sound like a lot, but the aircraft burns 110 gallons of fuel an hour, so we got about 2 to 2.5 hours of flight endurance on this aircraft. We currently have the aircraft set up for firefighting. We have an IMAN troop seat in here, which allows us to transport firefighters to remote fire locations if we have to. We also would normally put a cage here where they can put their axes, chainsaws, or anything, other equipment they may have. So it's kind of set up between the firefighting mode and construction mode right now since we don't have the cage. When we go on road trips, most of our job boxes with all the rigging, straps, and main cable are all back here. Another thing that's different about this aircraft compared to a lot of aircraft out there is this aircraft is magnesium. A lot of people may think it's aluminum. There are aluminum parts to it. The belly area, that's aluminum, but most part, everything else is magnesium on aircraft, just for the fact that when they built this aircraft, aluminum wasn't a readily available material, and it was more cost effective to use magnesium. A lot of helicopters don't have wheels. This being such a big aircraft, it allows us to taxi close to other aircraft without disturbing them with full power. The tail wheel is a full caster, 360 degrees. There's a T-handle up in the cockpit that we would pull. It would release a pin here, and then the tail rotor using the pedals allow us to steer the aircraft. Back in this section here, after the dry shaft from the angle gearbox goes in the main transmission, there's a smaller dry shaft that'll come back here to the tail section. After it goes through the tail through a series of hanger bearings, it comes to this point here. And we have what's called the angle gearbox. It's basically all its purpose is to redirect the dry shaft up to the tail rotor gearbox. It doesn't change speed, it just changes direction. You got the oil sight glass here, and then this is access for the chip plug. There's many chip plugs on the aircraft. They detect metal in the oil, let you know if the bearing's about to go out or having an issue. So the dry shaft goes up, connects to the tail rotor gearbox. Tail rotor gearbox, it's got a very important function. Keeps the aircraft lined up to where you want it to. It's an anti-torque system. I got four tail rotor blades back here. The tail rotor blades are basically constructed of a wood material wrapped up in aluminum. Coming over here, we finally get to our main cargo hook. Again, a pretty simple design. This is where we attach our main 100-foot cable. It'll slap right into here, and then we make sure it's locked by having that line lined up with the outer line. If it's off to the side, it means the hook is not locked and it has a chance of opening. So we make sure we check that. Our first job of the day, we do three checks to make sure we're able, in case of emergency, to release a load. There's two switches up in the cockpit for you to hit that this would open up. And there's also a manual lever just in case the electrical system is not working, where this would open, releasing the hook, or releasing the load. All right, this is this is the best seat in the house right here. Typically when we're flying cross country, I'll be sitting in this seat. And a mechanic or a rigger will be sitting in that seat helping navigate. During lift work, we can fly either in the right seat or in the left seat. Typically, all our pilots fly in the left seat just because the aircraft, when we're hovering, leans a little bit to the left, so it's easier to see what we're lifting. Basic cockpit setup, you get your attitude indicator, vertical speed indicator, altimeter, airspeed indicator, turn and bank coordinator, and then the other instruments are our torque, is basically what we read like power. Piston powered aircraft have a manifold pressure gauge, here it's for us is torque. And then down here is our rotor speed and power turbine speed, they call it the triple tack. Basically, once you're in the aircraft somewhat flies like an airplane, other than it's an unstable aircraft, you have to be on the controls all the time. The cyclic here, which controls the main rotor head and the pitch of all the blades, you pull back and the aircraft wants to climb up, you push forward, aircraft wants to descend, left and right. And then, so that, in that sense, it's the same as a regular aircraft once you're in flight. On a hover, push forward, you go forward, pull back, you go back, left and right. The thing that makes us go up in the air, and I'll turn it on here. It's called the collective. And the collective basically collectively changes the pitch of all the blades and that allows us to go up. So when we want to go up, we pull up. When we want to go down, we go down. The other thing is you look up in the rotor head, you can see all the different blades changing. And that's what happens in flight. You know, the blades are constantly moving and changing pitch as they go around in a circle. Now we pull up on the collective, that increases our power, which increases our torque. When we do that, we have to add left pedal, which gives our tail rotor thrust to counteract the aircraft wanting to spin. When we lower the power, it does just the opposite, add right pedal, and it keeps us in line.
Thanks for the tour, Jim. In part two, we're gonna go for a ride.